Say, no, I'm not like any kind of feminist that you've ever met. Chick, that is a yellow baby bird. I'm not yellow. I'm the color of fairer ugly ads before the girl gets the boy, the job, the life. My feminism knows appearance matters, but that's because she paints fabulous in every color. My feminism doesn't have angry, tearful breasts, but a pair that don't want to look at each other go in opposite directions. So she binds them together in a bra. My feminism calls these bait, and she says, hello, boys. My feminism loves boys. She has best friends, boyfriends, and a best man at her wedding. She doesn't hate men. Of course, they're mostly useless, but that's not really their fault. They're just victims of the same system that she thrives in. My feminism needs a drink of water because she's that hot. Feminism loves dressing up. Leather boots, backless chulis, Kanjivaram saris, knuckle dusters, and diamond solitaires. But my feminism is not hard. She cries when rape happens. She cries in a world that values control over consent. She aches over every no that goes unheard. Sexuality, relationship status, and gender regardless. My feminism sheds the unshed tears of all the men that she has ever. She breaks when she sees broken children. Underage is a crime whether it happens to a penis or a vagina. Yes, my feminism loves children. But it's a love that wears mischief and fun, not a maternity gown. My feminism wears her body and her choices. My feminism chooses books. Mila Kundera, Dostoevsky, Nancy Friday, and Nancy Drew. She gets together with Katniss Everdeen and Hermione Granger to laugh at Bella, that stupid vampire of hers. And my feminism wins poker against Frankenstein. Like every other monster, he was raised by a woman, Mary Shelley. British schoolers, right? My feminism also chooses dressing up, and you know that already, and she looks good in everything she wears. My feminism doesn't believe in slut shaming, fat shaming, any kind of shaming. She's shameless, blameless, but not nameless. She knows that great responsibility comes great power. So girl, if you're getting friendly with a lot of crotches, you better know how to take care of yourself when the shit hits the fan. And please stop moping about your weight and calling it cute things like plus size and real women have curves. Real women have self-esteem. My feminism gets a workout because she knows endorphins make up for all lost male attention. My feminism will not condemn you for sexualizing women. Sporting was made for sex. Good sex, lots of sex. Yeah, I said that. And when you're done thinking about that, she'll explain the difference between sexual object and sexual being. So don't cheat me, you. In a world of dogs, my feminism is a cat. Tigress, sea cat, alley cat, cougar. And guess how often my pretty, funny, flirty feminism lands on her own feet? Always. Meow. In a world that doesn't understand her, I'm an individual and my feminism is someone you haven't met. How many people here have been on a date? Come on, Allah, your parents are not here. Tinder dates?
Yeah.
Yeah? Okay. We're the adults here. Let's go to some listening. That's it? Only four of you? Okay. Since everybody has apparently is alien to dating, I'm going to take you through what dates look like. So let's do the dating thing. I'll say coffee, you'll say yup. I will spend the next half an hour wondering what yup means before I decide that it's some version of yes. We meet for coffee that turned into drinks because we both got late, but we'll both be on time, and then we worry that it looks odd to be on time, so we'll take a step back, hide in the shadows until we see the other person arrive, and then we say, hi, like, this is just one of the many things in our busy day. We start to talk about things that slight acquaintances say after they say hello. The weather in Mumbai, the traffic in Andheri, and how sober people will never get that. So colleges may never get that. And then the waiter instructs us to take our order. So we give the order and we go back to trying to reconstruct the conversation. The weather in Andheri, something about sober, and you were sane, and then you or I would say or do something incredibly wrong. Can you take the saying wrong part, please? I'm very proud of my words, but I have no ego about my grace. Right, that's decided there. So, you can say something slightly sexist, racist, homophobic, or politically incorrect, while I will fidget on my seat making those sounds. Embarrassment will come and settle down at our table, just like those unwelcome friends who show up when you're on a date. You will charm me by not even noticing. And I will impress you with my intelligent jokes about people who are just like us, but who are not us. We'll settle into this feeling of, I like this person so much, before we realize, this is just a date. Not even that, it's only supposed to be coffee. So we go back to staring at our drinks, not coffee, for an entire minute, trying to cover up this companionable conversation we almost had. This time, you can knock the glass over into my lap while I say something like, doesn't beer taste just like this? That's what you're drinking. We laugh. It'll be the laugh of people who are sharing embarrassment together, or maybe we just like hearing each other laugh. So now that we've read each other's cues correctly, we'll go back to talking about all the things that we can talk about. You see, it's very difficult to fall in love over coffee and act like that is not what's happening. But we're both working really hard, so this should carry us through for the next 1 hour or so. We really get on very nicely now. When the waiter arrives with the bill, he will hand it over to you, because that's what they always do in India. I will worry that you will think I'm cheap. I will protest probably more forcefully than I need to that I asked you out, so this one should be on me. You'll give me a strange look and you'll hand over your credit card, and I will know that in that moment it has stopped being this fun game of emotional hide-and-seek. When you walk out the door, you will not hold it open for me. I'll stop and I'll wonder, I'll try to remember whether you held it open for me when we walked in. Not that it matters, I'm a modern woman. Still, I will wonder. When I step out next to you, you'll turn around to look at me, and you will be looking for the same thing that I was looking for 2 minutes ago, that crucial 2 minutes that we are now off-sync. I'll pull up my automatic smile, but I'm only ever charming inadvertently. And your aloofness is not looking that hot either. So fine, this is over. We'll start to look for cabs in opposite direction. I'll get into the cab and I'll turn around and you will look at me, and somehow, in spite of everything that's happened, I'll find myself saying, I really did have a nice time. And you'll say,
yep.
And it's magical. Even though it happened in a crowded cafe at night, this was just supposed to be coffee, just a daily thing.
Yes. Are you doing paper planes?
Paper planes.
So I'm not going to use my mic. Can everyone hear me clearly?
Yeah. Better if you use the mic. For the camera.
I'll be loud. Can everybody hear me?
No, I think it's better.
Do you? Yeah.
Can you hold the mic?
I'm going to show you how to make a paper plane. Start with a sheet of paper. Pick one that means something to you. A love letter from someone who doesn't love you anymore. A page from a book that was a gift from someone you don't want to remember. An invitation to a wedding that you don't want to go to. Things to do list from the Wednesday that you last saw them. This is testimony to what they call your OCD and what you call life. Everything is neatly listed out. Pay bills, refuel car, renew library membership, and every item neatly checked off like you do your life. Every single item except one. Return alive. So take a sheet of paper just like this one that has all those emotions that don't fit neatly into lists, that keep moving out beyond your clock and your calendar, that just refuse to stay within your control. Take that sheet of paper and let's start. So let's start by folding it in. Do it carefully, because that's how you do everything. And fold it over one more time. You see, you've got to bury this deep down inside with all the things in your life that do work. There's always milk in your fridge. Your car is not out of petrol. And all your bills are paid on time. So let's bury it in, deep down in there. Put it in tightly. Don't let it get out. you take that last excuse out of your pocket. You know which one I'm talking about? This is the one that has you saying, but he loves me so much. She's my best friend. We are quite happy together. Yeah, take that excuse out. It's been holding all your lies together. Use it to hold your paper plane together. Put it in there. And now give it one more fold. And now, you take all those words that get caught between your teeth, all those emotions that get stuck at the back of your head and turn into nightmares when you sleep, all those relationships that you have only inside your own mind and make you grit your teeth at night and don't let it sleep and you get up in the morning with a headache, take all of those and breathe them into your brain. Give it wings. Then open your hands and take a look at what you made. You made it so pretty. You made a piece of art out of everything that burns deep inside you. You've taken it and put it right in there. Take one look at it, admire it, and then just let it go.
That's amazing, guys. Let's hear it. Let's hear it. These people have been waiting for 2 hours, 12 hours. And because I also say that